sing, hear it this morning. If he amazes you, come on and lift him up, pray. Give him all the glory. Lord, you deserve it. Pray with you this morning. And we're going to believe God and touch heaven with you. Amen. So please come forward. Come find him. Come seek him. Come get a love that is beyond all love. Amen. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. He's tapping on your heart's door this morning. God, we magnify you, Jesus. We worship you, Father. Hallelujah.
I just feel God moving in this place right here and right now. God is saying that without reservation and with open hand, have an open a door and have poured out my blessings and have given and given and poured out and poured out. And that this is a day that there will be no sparing. This is a day and this is an hour that there will be no lack of anything you need in your life whatsoever. This is a time of infinite and ultimate breakout and breakthrough in your life. And for those who will open up their hearts to God, they will see the tremendous power of the anointing that He is pouring out in this hour. That which you have only heard about and that which has seemed afar off, and that which appeared to be out of reach is right now upon you. I said is right now upon you. The time has come. Do not say it is coming, but the time has come right now. The people that I have died for to enter into a victory that is above everything that you can ever imagine, that is over the enemy, a victory that is over every situation and circumstances. That which has opposed you is now being removed out of the way. Those mountains that have stood there have been removed, the Lord says. And this is an hour and this is a day to enter into the blessing of God. For God is developing a people corporately and individually. A people that have had the work of the Holy Spirit manifested in them. There has been a change and there's been a transition that has taken place of such a degree that other people will look on and say, I want to serve the God of that individual. I want to serve their God. And God said, they will seek me, the one whom I have died for, and I will come and manifest myself unto them. This you will see what previous generations have only longed to see. But this is an hour that I am pouring out my spirit upon all flesh. And they will see my glory, and my glory shall rise upon you. The time has come. Rise and shine, for the light has come and the glory of the Lord has now risen upon you, says the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Would you just lift your hands one more time and just say, God, I receive everything you're doing in this hour, everything in my life. Come on, reach out to him and say, God, here am I. I long. I am hungry. I am thirsting. As the deer pants after the water brook, so pants my soul after thee, O God. Oh, blessed be your name, Jesus. God, I thank you. You know where every person is individually in this room. God, I thank you for what you're doing in their life and in their heart. Hallelujah. Manifest yourself. The glory of the Lord be upon us now. Jesus. 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 Glory. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you have any need, whatever it is, we got prayer warriors that know how to agree and touch and pray for you. Come as the Lord leads you to come into agreement with someone about whatever it is you're going through. And God to be glorified over your life, no matter what situation, personal, financial, physical, spiritual. We're here to pray for you today. God bless you today.
Joy, every fear suddenly wipes away. Here in your presence, oh, all of my cares now fade away. Every crowd, no longer on display.
Hallelujah. I really feel like we ought to offer up the craziest shout of praise we can on the count of three. Y'all ready to do that? Come on, I dare you just to let it go. Give him the high praise. Let the high praises of God be in your mouth. Give voice to shout. Come on, one, two, three. Come on, church. Bless the Lord. Glory. Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you, Lord. You're wonderful. Glorious. God. Amen. Turn to about three people and tell somebody, God is on your side. Would you do that? God is on your side. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. My wife is going to come and share a few things with you today. Sister Beverly. One of the most beautiful first ladies, pastor's wife, a preacher could ever have. Amen.
Good morning. God is blessing in the house, isn't he? Don't you just like to sit in his presence and just soak it in? He is so faithful to us. Well, if you're a guest here today, we are thankful that you are here and you walked into a great place where God's presence is, where God's people loves you, and we just want to say thank you for being here. There is a connection card inside of your bulletin if you would like to fill that out and just drop it in the offering and we'll send you more information about our church. And then if anyone else has a prayer request or a praise report, if you would like to put that on the back of the connection card, we will make sure that we pray over it. And I'm out of breath. I've been praising the Lord too much. So, and then we are having a yard sale that's coming up October the 27th. And this is going to be for our missions trip in 2013. And so it's time for us all to go. How many of you have those closets you have not cleaned out for a very long time? Nobody's going to admit it with me. Oh, come on. Well, this week we get to clean our house, because if you have anything that you can donate to that yard sale, clean it up a little bit, bring it to the church. Wednesday, I need a date on Wednesday. The 24th, thank you. So if you will bring it up here on Wednesday the 24th, and then we will get it prepared. Any of you could volunteer on Friday to come up and help us to clean it and label it and get it ready for Saturday, because we're believing for blessings to happen that day. So, and then today is life groups, and you have in your bulletin life groups, but we're going to change things on you today. How many of you like change? Yeah, I like that. I love change. So we're going to change things just a little bit, so you got to listen to me really closely. So we are going to combine two groups tonight, and that's going to be Advancing in Life, and that is Keith Houston and his wife Carrie on the front row over here at their house, and the address is in here, the 32 Thornbird Lane. We're going to have two groups at their house, and that's going to be Advancing in Life and then also Young Life. We're going to be meeting there, and they must going to be having some big party over there tonight. So bring your finger foods, bring your Bible, and enjoy some fellowship. Everybody is welcome to go. And then also we're having the Young at Heart, and they will be meeting here at the church. And I get to minister to you guys tonight, so we're going to have a good time here at the church. And I know this group, y'all love to cook good food, so we're going to have a good time tonight. And then the youth student life is going to be meeting tonight as well at the Cody Hooper. I started to say the Hooper's house, but there's a lot of Hoopers, so I better not say that. So at Cody and Courtney's house tonight, and the address is in the bulletin. And I believe Cody has some more things to share with us. And come on up, Cody, and share this with us.
I am the light of the world.
I am the salt of the earth.
I am anointed to preach the gospel, give to the poor and heal to the brokenhearted, set people free.
I am the feet of God taking His love into the world. I am the arms of God reaching out to the lost.
I am the hands of God pulling the fallen out of the darkness into His light.
I am the eyes of God looking past actions and into the heart.
I am the ears of God hearing the cries of those that are hurting.
I am the voice of God speaking life into a dead generation.
I am Echo.
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 Okay, now it's over. Echo Student Life Ministries. Oh no, a youth group has a name change. Echo Student Life, would y'all please stand up? That's all y'all kids back there. Y'all give them a round of applause. They did a lot of work in this video. They did a whole lot more work than I did. But we wanted to introduce this tonight. We've got a new name change, a new face, a new look, a new attitude. We are the Echo. Anybody here has ever heard the word Echo? You know what Echo is? Echo is like when you go to the Grand Canyon, you speak, and it echoes all over the place. The actual term, the definition of Echo is a sound resonating or reflecting off of an object. And that's what we want to be now is God's Word reflecting or echoing off of us into the world. And we are God's hands, we are God's eyes, we are God's feet, and we want to go out into the world showing God through us. We want to be an example of God. So that's why we're now going under the title of Echo Student Life Ministries. And we have the most dedicated missionaries on the face of the planet right here in our church. These kids, they face persecution, they face exile, they're shoved off into a corner, and we need to support them just like we support all of our missionaries, because they go out every day having to defend their faith and defend their actions before people and stand up and say that I believe in a God, and I want to show you who He is. And another exciting thing that we've got going right now with this whole new look and this whole new push, we want to be all about community, and we've got our Echo After Hours. Okay, Echo After Hours. This is going to be our student rec center. It's going to be open up on Friday nights at 7 to 11 o'clock. We're starting them on Friday nights. You can come play ping pong, pool, all kinds of video games, just hang out, play basketball. We're going to have open mic nights, where you can come in and read poetry, sing a song, do a drama, and just a place for the kids in this community of Kennedale. And we want Kennedale to be coming here, Life Fellowship Church to be the outpost of Kennedale, all the students in Kennedale. We want this to be the place to be. And we're starting with Echo After Hours. Our grand opening is November the 2nd. We're going to have a huge blowout. If you know any students in the area, okay, that just want to they're bored, or maybe you want a date night, bring them by here, drop them off. We're going to just have a ton of fun every Friday night, 7 to 11 o'clock. On that note, we're doing a lot of new things, a lot of new remodeling back there and stuff, so we need your support in prayer, and we need your support in finances too. Okay, we want to do a lot of remodeling, and we've also got, I've almost got every game. I've got a ping pong table for Pastor here. He's been, every time I mention game, you got a ping pong table, I want to tear everybody up. You got a ping pong table, I want to mess people up. Okay, that's all he would ever talk about. We finally got a ping pong table. We are needing a pool table. Okay, I've got basketball back there, video games back there, ping pong. I need a pool table. We've got one located. It's about $300. Or if somebody has one, they want to donate it to the church or anything like that, let God speak to your heart. And we're going to try to get that for the kids. Thank you very much. Echo, Student Life Ministries.
Praise the Lord. How many of you have been enjoying Bishop Olu's ministry? Amen. I've been encouraged and uplifted and challenged every time. Amen. He has some CDs at the back, and I wanted to just tell you a few of them. There's a two CD package that is on the blood, and it's $15. There's a lot of single CDs back there that are $10 each. This one is on the gates of your spirit, and it's two CDs. There's three CDs on Jesus, the law of recovery. How many of you need to recover some things from the enemy? Amen. There's also a wonderful 12 CD package back there that has the prayer revival. Every CD is about prayer. So if you want to be challenged in your prayer life, go ahead and get those afterwards. Miss Courtney will be there and be glad to assist you. God bless you.
Amen. And one last thing is our Cowboy Day is next Sunday. How many of you got your hats and your boots ready? We're going to have a Cowboy Day. And what we do is we dress up like cowboys and cowboy boots and jeans and hats and all that kind of stuff. If you don't have one, borrow one. If you don't, wear your Dallas Cowboy T-shirt. Maybe that'll help them win this year or something. So, but we are going to have a yeehaw time this coming Sunday, and we have a mechanical bull that you can ride. We'll have some bounce houses, hamburgers, hot dogs. Cakewalk, horseshoes. We are going to have a great, great time. Marshall Danny Robinson will be preaching next Sunday morning, and he has a stem winder, and he will preach the house down. We might have a banjo. We might have just a good old hee-haw time at Life Fellowship Church, and we do this for fun, but we do it to reach out to our community, to celebrate Jesus, and to have fun together. And right after church today, there's these little cards that you can take, and these are invitations that you can invite your friends and your family if you will take them right after service. And we are going to, we want to pray over them. I'm asking Cody to bring those up, and I want to ask you, we don't do this, we do it for fun. How many of you like to have a good time? But we want to win souls too. And we want to reach our city for Christ. And everybody loves to do something fun. So this is our main purpose, and this is our main goal, is to reach souls and have a great time doing it. So we have a mail-out that's going out this week, and I want you to help us make this effective. And we're going to lay hands. I want to ask you to stretch your hands towards this right now, and we're going to pray over this, that it will be effective for Christ. Lord, in the name of Jesus, Father, we send out your word through these cards, these invites to the house of the living God. And we ask you, Father, that you will anoint them. Father, let them just stick out in them when they receive them in the mailbox, Father. Help their heart to be pricked to come to the house of God. Lord, I pray that this event will go off perfect, that it will be exciting. It will be a great time, but most of all, that souls will be won for the Lord Jesus Christ. And we thank you for it in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And if you will make sure you pick up your cards on the way out the door, okay? God bless you guys. Love y'all.
Praise the Lord. You know what? If I wasn't a pastor, I'd go to this church. It's a wonderful church. This is just a wonderful church. Life Fellowship is great. And I thank God for what he's doing. I thank God for this church. I think of all the things we're doing. I think of our nursing home ministry, ministers to 15 to 20 nurse people at the nursing home at Pecan Manor, and I thank God for Luke heading that up. Our beach club that reaches every single week on a Thursday right after school at the Delaney Elementary. Who'd ever thought that we'd ever be able to get into the elementary schools? And we're reaching above 60, 70 kids every single week with what we do here at the church and minister to them. And it's being so effective. We have prison ministry where they're learning and memorizing curriculum. And James and Sharon Matthews heads this up. I'm signing Bibles every single week for ladies that have memorized certain scripture and have completed a curriculum. And I sign Bibles so that we give to them Bibles. Our women's ministry, men's ministry, youth ministry, children's ministry, our media ministry that Mike Carroll has started. He has labored so diligently in honor and glory for the Lord so that this could take place, that my parents who aren't able to be here, they live in Waxahachie and had some physical challenges, they're able to watch us on the World Wide Web while we're having church. And my dad told my mother, said, if I can't go to Danny's church, I'm not going anywhere else, so we'll watch it right here on Ustream. And so it's on Ustream in Kennedale. Just go to Ustream and you can pull it up. I watched all last service, last Sunday service. It was the same anointing that was here in that service came through on that World Wide Web. It touched me. It was so powerful, effective, and ministry. And it just such a blessing. Our worship ministry. How many of you appreciate this worship team that we have? Aren't they wonderful? They're just so wonderful. Our greeters, man, I could go on. There's still more that I haven't named. But, you know, it's because of your faithfulness. It's because of your obedience to the Lord. It's because of your worship in the area of tithing and giving that we're able to make all this happen. And how many of you believe God is glorified with what's going on? I believe we haven't even reached the top, you know, reached the surface. But I'm here to tell you, because of the faithfulness of God's people, we are able to continue to do what we do. And just to be able to gather in this building. The lights are, you know, some people think, I wonder if how they think the lights do come on. You know how they come on? Because of the faithfulness of God's people. That's how. People come and they tithe and they give, and we're able to meet here at Little Road and Sublet, a place that's visible, accessible, and undeniable. When people drive by, they're going to want to come and be drawn in by the Holy Spirit. So good things are happening, great things are happening. And we want you to just worship the Lord this morning. I want the ushers to prepare. If you have an offering envelope, just put on their tithes or other, and may God bless you today as you give. We don't just drop money into an offering bucket, but we're tithing the first fruits of all of our increase, and we worship the Lord. Just it tells us in Deuteronomy 26 that they came and brought their fruit at the place in the basket where God has chosen to put his name, and they were to declare with their mouth. They were to say something. How many of you know we say something, we do something? What we say is that God brought us out of Egypt and brought us into a promised land. How many of you glad that God brought you out of the kingdom of darkness and translated you into the kingdom of your dear son? Amen to God. Amen to God. God is faithful, and we worship him today. We honor the name of the Lord, and we give him glory for all he's doing and for the lives that are touched and the eternal difference that is making in people's lives. If you have a check, make it out to LFC and just put it in the envelope, and God bless you as you give. Ushers, come ahead, and these men will minister to you today in the area of tithe and offering. Kids, I want you to get ready. We always bless the kids every Sunday. I've done it for almost 20 years. We want to bless you today. We want to honor you today, the kids. Would you hold your offerings in your hand, and let's pray. Father, I thank you this morning for your church, that you are building your church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Thank you for what you're doing, Father. Thank you for your power and your glory that's manifested in this place. I pray favor, peace, and increase upon every person. I pray, God, you will go before us and open doors that need to be opened, close doors that need to be closed. We will acknowledge this is the hand of the Lord working in our life and that it's marvelous in our eyes. Be glorified, Father, we pray, in the name of Jesus and for your glory. Amen. God bless you, usher. Kids, if you'd come on up to the front, let me bless you today. Come on, kids. for the kids as we pray for them. Father, I thank you for every one of these children, what you're doing in their life. We declare the Lord bless you and the Lord keep you and the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. I bless you with sound minds, health in your bodies, angels to surround you all the days of your life. I bless you from children to know the Holy Scriptures. It's able to make you wise unto salvation. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you, kids. Love you so much. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, this is the last Sunday morning that Bishop Olu Lawrence will be with us. This is the most different thing I've ever done in 28 years of ministry. But I know when I hear the Lord. And when he was here 4 weeks ago on Sunday morning and ministered, I asked, can you come Wednesday? And we had his plane scheduled to go back to Houston. And we had to cancel it. So he was here Wednesday. And I said, can you be here Sunday? And he said, Pastor, the Lord's already told me I'll be here for a little while. And I said, Barely cancel the flight again. So we canceled the flight three times, I think, in the course. But you know what? I have enjoyed this immensely. How about you this morning? I tell you, Bishop Olu has blessed our life. And someone said, you ought to be ready to preach when you get back in the pulpit. I will be ready. You better just buckle your seatbelt because I will be ready. Bishop also has a prayer revival CDs you might consider. And this is a set of, I think, 12 CDs about prayer. And you know, as we have known, he comes to this church and has been praying from 1 in the morning till 6 and 7 o'clock in the morning every single night. And when I've come up here and I heard him one night praying, I knew that he was praying at a whole different level. I tell you what, I appreciate this. This is his calling. That's what he does. He goes into cities. He goes into nations and churches. And he prays, and that is his calling. And he gets to preach on the side a little bit while he prays. But his ministry is a prayer ministry. God has used him effectively to bless us, to minister to us. We've been encouraged. We've been inspired. We've been empowered by the Holy Ghost in these last 4 weeks. And this today, I want you to open up your heart. I want you to get ready for anything God will do, what he will do in your life. I want you to give Bishop Olu Lawrence a great Kennedale welcome. Live fellowship, welcome as he comes and ministers to us this morning once again. God bless you, Bishop.
Somebody give him glory in the house. Is that all the glory you can give to him? Come on, give him glory. Come on, somebody give him praise. Come on, give the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords some praise this morning. Jam your hands and let the praises go up this morning. Come on, somebody, give him praise in the house. Come on, you can do better than that. Give him praise in the building. Come on, somebody, give him praise in the house. Can you see his glory in the house this morning? You will never be the same again. You will never be the same again. I know that you will never be the same again. Glory. Is anybody sick in this house this morning? Anybody been tormented by the enemy? Is the devil harassing you? Even if you can't fight, you have people that can fight for you. So if you have some ailments in your body right now, and that you want God to touch you now, so I want you to rise up on your feet and walk down to this altar that you believe that the power of God resonates on this altar that will cause a change in your life forevermore. That will cause transformation in your life forevermore. The power of God is here right now.
then you ought to go all over the city of Kennedale and let them know that the power of God is in life fellowship. Are you hearing me? I said, are you hearing me? Lift up your hands and worship Him like you have never done all your life. Like you have never done all your life. Come on, Tammy. Where is Tammy? Tammy, will you please come back here and give me some worship song that these ones that are waiting for healing this morning, you will worship Him like this is the last day of your life to worship Him. And every ailment in your body, in your soul, in your spirit, every pain, every sickness, every harassment that the devil is giving you, the power of God is touching you right now. Yes, it's touching you right now. And that you would never be the same. Not another day of your life. I want you to believe God this morning. Believe Him like you have never done before. The Bible says, who had believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Who in this house have believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? If you believe His report say about 2,000 years ago, you are healed. Can I have an amen in this building? Give me some voice in this building. Because this is a miracle church. A miracle church is a noisy church. A noisy church is a shouting church. Can I have some noise in this house? Come on, give me some. Let them worship. Let them just sing. Let them jump. Let them praise Him like they are out of their mind this morning. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Yes, Lord. The power of God is in this building right now. You will never be the same again. Not another day of your life. Not another day of your life. Not another day of your life. Come on, somebody praise Him in the house. Come on, somebody praise Him in the house. Yes. Yes. Come on, come on. Give Him praise in the house. Begin to give Him praise in the house. It is your turn. It is your time. Whenever it's your turn, it's your time. It's your time to celebrate and be healed. The power of God is touching you already. The power of God is ministering to you already. Because you will never be the same again. The hand of God is upon you. Yes. The one that can dance. Give me something. Say something. Sing something. Make something up. They're gonna dance anyhow.
Walk with me through fire.
Isaiah chapter 53 verse 1. Who has believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrow and acquainted with grief, and we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrow, yet we esteem him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. By the authority of the scripture, by the uniform testimony of the word of the living God, I declare the power of God to heal you. In the name of Jesus, be healed. 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 In the name of Jesus, be healed. Be healed. Be healed. Be healed. In the name of Jesus, be healed. In the name of Jesus. Your hands and worship him. Be healed in the name of Jesus. Be healed in the name of Jesus. You will never be the same again. Not another day of your life. Up your hands. You know you are healed. You know he has touched you. Jump up and begin to bless him right now, like you have never done before. Can you do that? Watch me. Do that. Do that. Begin to. Come on. Come on. Come on now. Come on. Let the fire of the Holy Ghost. Come on. Come on, sister. Come on. Come on. Come on now. Come on. Come on. Come on. Yes. 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 Fire of the Holy Ghost. In the name of Jesus, you will never be the same again. Not another day of your life. I don't want you to go. I want you to check yourself. Now, check that leg, check that chest, check the waist, check everywhere now. Wherever you are, I want you to check yourself. Is anybody know that you know that you know you've been touched? I need to see your hand. If you know that you know you've been touched, and I want you to come. I give you 1 minute. Come on. Come on, put your hands together. Come on in the house.
I can breathe easier, and I just don't feel any more ache or pain.
Come on, somebody give him glory in the house. If you know that you know that you know that the power of God touched you this morning, I need you to raise up your hand and share with the people of God so the faith of somebody can increase. Yes, ma'am. Come on. Share with the church.
My back has been hurting and it's been shooting down my leg and it's stopped. So I'm healed in the name of Jesus and I receive that.
Come on, give him praise in the house. Come on, church. You will never be the same again. Hallelujah. You can go. Come on.
Praise the Lord for the living God is here. Praise the Lord.
Well, somebody give him glory. The living God is here.
I receive a touch for a sister in the Lord that died in. I asked her to come to church today. She has cancer. She's swollen really bad. I lay hands in her. But I believe that when you touch me, I went in front of her, my children, and another person, not me. I don't care for me. I care for the glory of Jesus. I will rebel.
Come on, somebody praise him in the house. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Wow. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Woo. Leave her alone. Leave her alone. Let her rest in the arm of Jesus. Let Jesus walk on her. Let Jesus touch her. Let Jesus bless her. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. Thank you. I'm sorry I have to call you guys. You're not. Woo! I love this praise team. They make something up. I bless the Lord. Are you ready to eat? Is anybody hungry in the house? I said, is anybody hungry in the house? All right. I want you to turn to the person next to you and say, neighbor, so glad you are sitting next to me. You are very lucky. I bless God for you. In the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody give him praise. Let's bow down our heads. Holy Spirit, thank you because of who you are. And thank you for Life Fellowship Church. I bless your name for Pastor Danny and Beverly. And thank you for all the elders of this church. I worship you for the praise team, the prayer warriors. I thank you for all the ushers and all the women and the men. I thank you for all the pastors that are in charge of the youth and the children teachers. And I ask that the glory be unto you, O Father, in the name of Jesus. Thank you for this city. And thank you for what you're beginning to do in this city. Thank you for your presence working in this city. And I know that this city will never be the same again. And I know that the people in Life Fellowship Church will never be the same again. And therefore, this morning, let your voice echo from heaven into the soul and spirit of every man watching tonight by television, by the internet. I ask that your voice echo into every room, into every house that are watching this program on today. And for those that are in church this morning, every oppression, every discouragement that the enemy placed upon you by the authority given to me as a New Testament apostle, I command those burdens to be destroyed right now. I command the oppression to be destroyed right now in the name of Jesus. Bless your people with good hearing. Bless everyone with great understanding. Bless everyone with great knowledge. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Genesis chapter 12. This morning, where we enter into the Word of God as I speak to you, on the principle of building an altar. The principle of building an altar. The principle of building an altar for your healing, for your prosperity, for your outstanding success in life. You know, and I know that you gave your life to Christ. You are saved. But you are still here on earth. You are not dying now. And because you are still here, you need to be successful. You need to prosper. You need to progress in every area of your life. And I believe that's what church is meant for. Church is meant to teach you, to help you,
so you can excel in every area of your life. What is principle? Principle are precepts. Principle are precepts. What is precept? Pre means idea. Sept means before. So when you hear the word precept, it means idea before. The Bible talks about precept upon precept. In other words, idea upon idea. The idea of God. What is God thinking before now? What is God thinking before you woke up? What is God thinking before you were created? Before you moved to Kennedale, what was God thinking? Before you joined Life Fellowship, what was God thinking about you? What was God's idea concerning you? God is a sweet God, a loving Father who always thinks greatness concerning His own children. The Bible said the thoughts of God is higher than our thoughts. Just as the heavens is higher than the earth, so the thought of God is higher than our thought. So what is the thought of God concerning you this morning? I know I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospereth. Everything God think about you, about me, is positive. Everything. When God give you an idea, when God give you a commandment, when God give you an instruction, that instruction is not to benefit God, but the instruction is to benefit you. Can I have an amen in the building? So, what is God's principle is this morning concerning you becoming the dream that you had about yourself? What is God's principle? Look at Genesis. This teaching today is for the senior class. It's for the senior students. Oh yes. That wants to excel quickly. This is a secret of excelling quickly. It's not for the junior class. This is not for those that have time to say, will that work? Will this work? Or will this not work? This is for those that wants to launch out into the deep. This is for the senior student class of success. Look at Genesis chapter 12, verse 7. Principles of building an altar. Genesis 12, 7. Then, somebody say then. I can't hear you. Again. Say it again. And again. Say it until you are angry. Then the Lord appeared to Abraham and said, to your descendant, I will give this land. And there he built an altar to the Lord, who had appeared to him. And he moved from there to the mountain east of Bethel. And he pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. The Bible says, God appeared to Abraham, and Abraham built an altar in the place that God appeared to him.
What is the principle of altar building? An altar, like the one we have here, a raised platform that is consecrated to God. This altar was raised to receive you into the presence of God. This altar was raised to receive blessings for you. This altar was raised for sacrifice, for worship. It's not just a place to stand. It's a place to receive. Because when Pastor Danny came here and this place was built, he could have left the place without an altar. But altar was built. So the altar can receive you, and not just you. The altar he built in Kennedale will receive his children. Children. Why? Because altar lives. Altar does not die. So every altar that you build, live for you. And every altar that you build, speak for you. So Abraham came to the place and he built an altar. And he called upon the name of the Lord. That is the secret of your breakthrough. When I came to Kennedale 4 weeks ago, I came in the middle of the night on Saturday night. I woke up to build an altar in a place I've never been before. And I called on the name of the Lord. And he came into that room that I built an altar. And the next time I was to worship upon my altar, the thing got exploded. And Nathan said, would you like to go to church? Because maybe he doesn't want the neighbor to think we're fighting. Because I became so loud. And I was thinking in my mind, somebody might think that something is wrong with these people downstairs. And then he said it to me in a nice way, so that you can have more freedom. And I said, okay. I think I will have more freedom when I go to church. And I came to your church and I build an altar. And I invite the Almighty to that altar. And he came. And ever since then, he's been living in your church. You didn't hear that. He's not just living in your church. Whenever God is invited to a place where altar is built, he comes and bless the place. He did not just come and bless the place. He blessed the place for your children. And I will soon show you that in the Word of God. About 3 years ago, a family in Palestine invited me to their acres of land. Over 100 acres of land. And they live on that property. And they said, Bishop, we want you to come and bless this property. Because we believe that there is oil in this property. But we don't know if that's true or not. And then one afternoon, somebody drove me to the house and we stood in the middle of the property. And then he said, will you please pray? And as we pray, and I saw through the earth cross, and I saw black thing moving, like flowing, like river, underneath, thick, dark, black. And I declare it into the air, that this is what I saw in your land. And they were excited, they were happy. And that was the case. And I told them that somebody has already paid for this land to be blessed. I was telling the husband and wife,
I don't know who paid, but one person among your relation has already paid. It was then the wife told me that the Palestinian church that invited me to preach in that land, that house down there was her mom's house. And that was there the church started. And I said, that's it. From that day that the mother opened up that house, an altar was built. And the Almighty was invited. And he came and blessed that land. And the mom is no more. But that place is already blessed for the children, 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 children. About 2 weeks ago, here in Kennedale, she called me. And she said, Bishop, I said, yes, mama. I have many mamas. Don't worry about it. I've won in Kennedy too. And she said, you remember, you said this when you bless our land. I said, yeah. She said, I'm just overwhelmed by what God is doing. We already signed a lease for the drilling to commence on our land. And we think you should be first to know, because the check is, you have some part of the check that is coming in. And I said, how many of you love the Holy Ghost? How many of you love the Holy Ghost in the house? You are not acting like you love the Holy Ghost. I thought somebody ought to be running around the church by now. I thought somebody ought to be shouting in the building by now. The power of the Spirit of God. You build an altar in a place, God is invited. And God come to bless that altar. But an altar is not an interesting place. Because on the altar, you dump everything. When you build an altar in your house or in this place, you build an altar for God to receive your junk. You build an altar for God to receive all your mess. You build the altar for God to receive all the dirty things of your life. You confess your sin upon the altar. You bring all your dirty linens upon the altar. And you tell God on the altar all that is wrong with you. All the disabilities of your life. And you tell God, I'm no good. And you tell God, something is wrong with me. I cannot serve you like I want to. Help me, Jesus, to serve you. And you lay yourself upon the altar. Because it was an altar that sacrifices are dumped. So every altar receives sacrifice. Jesus was sacrificed upon the altar of Calvary. And on that altar of Calvary, blood began to flow. So an altar is a messy place. An altar is a stinking place. An altar is a dirty place. But that stinking and dirty place, that's where God wants to stay. He wants to rest in that place. So when he rests in that place, you receive your sacrifice and then abide in that place forever, watching over you. Not just you, your children. Your children, children. You know, some children get away with whatever they do. And some, they didn't even do anything. They were in the wrong place at the right time. Bam, they go in for it. Because of mama's altar. Because of papa's altar. That they have built. Their children get away. The altar speaks. Every altar speaks. Abraham built an altar to the Lord. And he blessed the place. And Abraham was dead. Long gone. Genesis 33. Let's see what happened. Are you sitting in the house? You will never be the same again. Genesis 33. Look at what happened. He built an altar. He was gone. He was dead. Genesis 33. Verse 18. Stay with me this morning. Then Jacob came safely to the city of Shechem, which is in the land of Canaan, when he came from Paddan Aram, and he pitched his tent before the city, and he bought the parcel of land where he had pitched his tent from the children of Hamor, Shechem's father, for 100 pieces of money. Then he erected an altar there and called it El Elohim Israel. Let me make some connection. Shechem was the place that Abraham built an altar when he came to Canaan. And he blessed the place and invited God. And since that time, God has been there. Isaac was born. And Isaac had his own children. And everybody went away. Jacob went to Mesopotamia. Esau was in another place. But a day came when Jacob was returning from where he went to serve Laban. And everything that happened in his life. Guess where he decided to buy land? In the place that Abraham built an altar. Because altar talks. Altar speaks. Altar calls. Altar draws. The altar of drunkenness that some father built. And they say, I'm not doing anybody anything. They build that altar. And their children is on that altar till tomorrow. The altar of prostitution that men build. And they said, I'm not hurting anybody. Who said that to you? Everything that you do, you are hurting somebody. Every negative thing that you do, you are hurting somebody. And the world deceives you. They say it's your body. Do whatever you want with it. It is not like that, church. You want to hear the truth? It was borrowed to you. You are living on a borrowed body. And the owner is watching. Is watching what you do with what he borrowed you. Because one day he's going to ask you for it. Some build the altar of nonchalant attitude. They're pregnant, but they're still taking drugs. Shooting the needle. They're building altar of destruction for the unborn baby. For the unborn child. And it's coming to hunt them. Whether you like it or not, because altar speaks. And then you say, who told the child? Nobody. Let me tell you a story. An old man was on a farm, raising his children. And he had a stubborn child. And he told the son, go to the other end of the farm. Get me some water from the pond to drink. And the stubborn boy pee-pee in the father's water. And the father drank it.
And day after day, night after night, year after year, the same little boy grew up on the same farm. And he had his own child on the same farm. And one day, he sent his own little boy to go to the same pond and bring him water to drink. The little boy poo-poo in his water. Are you hearing me? And he was about to slap the little boy to death. And his father was still alive on the other end of the farm. And the father said, don't you ever touch him. Just like you pee-pee in my water, I drank it. You should drink the water he poo-poo in. And the man said, who told him? Otter speaks. Whatever seed you plant today will grow. And the seed will speak. You are not hearing me. You are about to push me to the limit now. You are about to hear the word of God today. That you will never be the same again. All the days of your life. Am I speaking to this church? Are you hearing me? Otter speaks. Every seed you plant, some seed take 3 months to grow. Some seed 6 months. Some 1 year. Some 3 years. But the thing is, they will surely grow and bring forth harvest. Jacob came and bought a parcel of land from where Abraham, the grandfather, had already blessed. Then you say, who told him? I don't know. But let's make some another connection. Jesus Christ. Ooh. I don't know if Otter can affect Jesus. But Otters affect Jesus himself. Oh my goodness. Turn your Bibles to John chapter 4. You want to? You will never be the same again today. John chapter 4, verse 3. Otters affected Jesus himself. The Lamb of God. The lily of the valley. The bright and the morning star. The one that knows all things. The one that can do all things. The one that is coming back again to judge every man. John chapter 4 verse 3. He left Judea and departed again to Galilee. But he needed to go through Samaria. When you read your Bible and you hear, he needed to go through Samaria. Why should the Lamb of God needed to go through Samaria? Verse 5. So he came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar. Make the connection. Shechem in the Old Testament is the same Sychar in New Testament. It's just a question of Hebrew and Greeks. Look at it. He came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being weary from his journey, sat thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. Jesus was going on his way. There are other directions to go to where he was going. But the Bible says, he needed. Something was pushing him. Something was calling him to go through that direction to get to where he was going. And when he got there, there was a well in the place. In the beginning, it was an altar that was built. But at this time, altar has grown. Sacrifices upon sacrifices upon sacrifices. So it's no longer water. It has metamorphosed into a well. The altar you build, and you continue to build, and you continue to build, and you are getting wearied, and you are getting tired, and you are getting discouraged, and you are saying, when am I going to be blessed? I've been paying my tithe all my life. When am I going to reap? I've been sowing seed all my life. When am I going to receive? Nobody is giving to me. Nobody is looking after me. Nobody is thinking about me. I have a word for you today. Keep planting that seed. Keep growing that seed. Keep giving that offering. Keep paying that tithe, because it will soon turn to a well. And what does that mean? When it turns to a well, your children will no longer need to build an altar. I don't know if somebody is listening to me. They will no longer struggle the way you struggle. They will no longer need to pray the way you pray. Because you have done all the prayer, they begin to drink from that altar. That is what happened to Jesus. And he sat on that well. And a woman came. And Jesus talked with the woman. Give me to drink, woman. And the woman said, what business have I with you, a Jew in Samaria? There is nothing common between two of us. Because the Samaritans are regarded as the illegal Jews. It's like half-half. It's either their mother is a Jew and their father is not a Jew. So when a Jew, man or woman, have a child with another tribe or the other group of people, they regard those children as non-Jew. That's what is happening between Jesus and this woman. The woman said, well, since when a Jew asking a Samaritan woman for water? And Jesus said, I wish you know who is asking you. You will have asked me to give you a living water, and I will have given it to you. And the woman said, are you greater than our father that gave us this well? And himself drank from it? And Jesus told the woman, the water that I give to you, when you drink it, it will produce well inside you. And you don't have to come here to get water anymore. And the woman said, wait a minute, I've never heard about that water in my life. Now I need you to give me that water now. And Jesus said, go home, go call your husband. And the woman said, there's a problem there. I don't have husband. And Jesus said, you are right. Even the one you have now is not your husband. Word of knowledge kicked in. Word of wisdom kicked in. And the woman said, you are the Messiah. And she ran to the city and tell everybody, I saw a man who told me everything that I've ever done. Come and see him. And the whole city came to see Jesus. Ooh. When you pay tithe to the living church, you are building an altar. When you bring your offering to a living church, you are building an altar. When you come to a living church and you are part of the praise team, you are building an altar. When you come to a living church and you are serving in the children department, and you are serving in the media department, and you are serving in the usher's board, and you are serving in different capacity in the church, you are building an altar. And the altar that you build today, that altar will call upon your children tomorrow. My grandmother was not educated. She couldn't read the Bible. And I don't know how she got the understanding. She wakes me up every day, 5 o'clock in the morning, 5:30 in the morning, to take me to morning prayer. And I cry every day because I don't want to go. And my mother wants to break my head into two because my crying just makes that woman tired. Every morning I cry. We walk down to church and I'll be humming behind them. But my grandmother never stopped waking me up. She wakes me up every day. I think she just forget that I was going to cry. And when I get to church, pastor preach that early morning, I am standing by the door crying. And make sure that I don't even get inside the church. I will stay in the church cry. And after he finished preaching, we're going home. It's time to go to school. I stop crying. And they wake me up the next morning. And my grandmother was building an altar. That she was aware, she knew, I believe in her spirit, that my grandson will preach the word of God to nations, including Kennedale, to Life Fellowship, all over the nation of the earth. She didn't see that in the physical. She saw that in the spirit. And she was persuaded. And she kept doing it. She kept building that altar. And on this day, I challenge every one of you in this house to build the right altar for your children to come. Every offering that you bring to the house of God is an altar building. It's accumulating. It's increasing. Even when you don't have, you make sacrifice. You are building an altar. Do you know what I learned in the place of prayer? God does not only answer your prayer. God reward you for your time. God reward you for your painstaking. God reward you for your sleep. God reward you for every hour that you spend in His presence. Not only that, God also award you blessing for coming to the place of prayer when it was not convenient, when the weather was chilly cold. But you choose to be in that cold because you are going to give God a sacrifice. A sacrifice. That normally you will be sleeping and wrap yourself in the bed because it's cold. But you get up to give God a sacrifice. And heaven pay attention to that. Heaven look beyond and see the sacrifice that you are bringing. I was told about a lady in this church that cut the hair for all the children while they were going back to school. That was a sacrifice. She's building an altar for her own children and children. Every time you open this door and the lights are on, and those of you that make that happen, you are building an altar of illumination into your life. And your life will never be in darkness. Your marriage will never be in darkness. Your business will never be in darkness. And you will never run into bankruptcy. Because you have chosen to build an altar unto the Lord. You build an altar. And invite God to that place. Let me show you. Two people. That build an altar. Turn your Bible to 2 Kings. 2 Kings. Are you getting anything? 2 Kings chapter 4. This woman that I'm about to read her story to you. She built an altar to the Lord. But she probably don't know that she was building an altar to the Lord. Second Kings chapter 4 verse 8. Now it happened one day that Elisha went to Shunem, where there was a notable woman. And she persuaded him to eat some food. So it was. As often as he passed by, he would turn in there to eat some food. Listen to this story. Listen to this story about food. It's not just food. It's food with a difference. Verse 9. And she said to her husband, "Look now, I know that this is a holy man of God who passes by us regularly. Please," verse 10, "let us make a small upper room on the wall, and let us put a bed for him there, and a table, and a chair, and a lampstand. So it will be whenever he comes to us, he can turn in there." Verse 11. And it happened one day that he came there, and he turned in to the upper room and lay down there. The man of God was going by his business, and this woman will say to him, "Do you need some water to drink, sir?" And the man of God said, "That's okay. Yes, please." And then she offered water. And while he's drinking, she will say, "What about a piece of cake? Or some meal?" And the man of God said, "Okay." And she will feed this man of God. Because of God, she fed him. Every time he passes by, they don't know each other. He doesn't know her. And then she went to her husband and whispered, "Honey, I think this is a man of God. I think we should make a little room for him. So whenever he passes by, he can rest." "Well, maybe I will have asked my wife, did he ask you for a place?" "Oh no, but I thought it would be okay." And like a typical man, okay, go and do whatever you want to do. Leave me alone. "Oh, you do that too?" And the woman quickly called a carpenter, bought the wood, and make a little room. And the man of God didn't even know. As he was coming by, "Oh, we have a place for you." She was excited. She bought a bed. She bought a table, a chair, and a lampstand. There was no air condition. But that's okay. Elijah probably don't need air condition anyway. And when he was passing by, he lay on the bed. Verse 12. Then he said to Gehazi, his servant, "Call this Shunammite woman." When he had called her, she stood before him. Listen to this story very well. "And it came to pass, say now to her, 'Look, you have been concerned for us with all this care. What can I do for you?'" Elijah was to be taken away to heaven. And Elisha was following him. And everybody would discourage Elisha. "Your master is being taken away." And Elijah finally asked Elisha, "What can I do for you? What do you want?" And I am asking Life Fellowship the same question on this day. Before I leave you, you don't know if I'm an angel. But what can I do for you before I go? You don't know whether I'm for real. But what can I do for you before my departure from you? Elijah said, "What can I do for you? What do you need?" And the woman said, "I don't need anything. I dwell in among my people." And Elijah was asking the woman, "Can I speak to the king on your behalf?" Elijah wanted to give the woman a political connection. And the woman said, "That was my uncle. I know everybody. I don't need anything." But Elijah was still worried. What am I supposed to do for this woman? Look at verse 14. So he said, what then is to be done for her? And the guest then answered, actually, she had no son, and her husband is old. So he said, call her. When he had called her, she stood in the doorway. Then he said, about this time next year, you shall embrace a son. And she said, no, my Lord, man of God, do not lie to your maiden servant. The power of God is here right now. Is anybody that is looking for the fruit of the womb? Stand up on your feet. Do not come here, just stand up. You want God to touch your womb, wherever you are, stand up. God bless you. There's no shame in church. Stand up on your feet, just stay where you are. God bless you, sister. Thank you. You want to carry your own baby. You want to dance with your baby in the middle of the night. What a joy. Any other person? According to the time of life, I speak it to you that you shall embrace a man child. According to the time of life. Because there is time for everything. And so shall it be. This time, 2013, you will have your child. In the name of Jesus. And put your hand on your womb right now. And feel the baby kicking. By faith. Do that for me. And go everywhere. Toys R Us. Mother care, get ready. Baby is coming in the house. Do you receive it? Do you receive it? So shall it be. According to the time of life, by the word of the living God, you will carry your twins in the name of Jesus. And so shall it be. By the word of the living God. You believe it? So shall it be. Rub that womb right now. That's it. And feel that baby kicking. I can feel it for you. Because I'm also pregnant. I'm pregnant of greatness for life fellowship. I am pregnant of greatness for life fellowship. And I'm going to deliver my baby very soon. It don't look like I'm pregnant, but I'm pushing right now. And I'm about to give birth to a great life fellowship church that you will never forget in your life in the name of Jesus. So Elisha said, according to the time of life, you will have your child. And the woman said, no, man of God, don't deceive me. Verse 17, but the woman conceived and bore his son when the appointed time had come of which Elisha had told her, and the child grew. Now it happened on a day, you know the story. The child grew. The child was running around. But one day the child was sick. And the child was with the father. And the father called the mom, take this boy's running temperature. And the woman took the son, and the son died. And she took that dead son to the room that she built for the man of God. And she laid that baby on the bed of Elisha. And she called the servant and said, get me one of the horse. Told the husband, I need one of the servants to ride with me. Where are you going? He said, I'm going to see the man of God. The father did not know that the boy has passed on. And the husband said, is everything okay? She said, it shall be well. And the power of God is in the house right now. And she ride that horse like something else is wrong with him. When they got to where the man of God was, the servant of the man of God don't want her to touch the man of God. The man of God said, leave her alone. Something is bothering her. And the man of God sent his servant and said, go. Don't talk to anybody on the way. If anybody talks to you, don't answer. Just go straight to my room. But afterward, the man of God followed. When Elisha got to the room, he laid on the baby. His mouth to the baby's mouth. His ear to the baby's ear. And he breathed on the baby, and the baby sneezed. But this is the connection. The bed that she paid for. The room that she built. That was the same room that brought her life. Oh, you are not hearing me. That was that room that life came back to her. The investment she made, the altar she built, and she did not know who she was building the altar for. That was the altar that produced life for her little boy. Are you hearing me? The power of God is here right now. And I'm about to give you an altar call in a few minutes. And the power of God is here to touch whoever will obey. Let me tell you something. A day came. David was already introduced to the palace. And Jonathan, of all people, saw that David would be the king after his father. And Jonathan stripped himself of his royal robe. He stripped himself of everything, the sword, and gave it to David. He said, I know God have anointed you to be king instead of my father. And when you become king, I will be next to you. He stripped his throne and gave it to David. He built the altar for his future. He built the altar for his children's children. Eventually, Jonathan died. And David became king. And everyone in the house of Saul have died. For one reason or the other. And David became king in Jerusalem. And one day, he stood up in his palace and asked his aides, is anyone remaining of the house of Saul that I may show kindness to him? And they brought in Ziba. And he said, yes, my lord. Jonathan have a son. His name, Mephibosheth. He dwell in Lodiba. Lodiba is a dry place. Mephibosheth, the meaning is suffering. His name is suffering and he dwell in a desert. Forgotten. Rejected. Cast out. Forever. But a king, remember, because of the altar that Jonathan built. And he said, go and bring Mephibosheth for me. They brought Mephibosheth from the desert into Jerusalem, into the palace. And when Mephibosheth came to the palace, David said, are you Mephibosheth? And you know he was lame. Mephibosheth, yes, my lord, the king. He was scared. And David said, don't be afraid. From today, you shall eat bread on my table. The change that came to Mephibosheth will come to you. The change. The transformation. The new life. The newness. The new history. The new story that came into the life of Mephibosheth is about to happen to some of you here. The story that you are telling now, you're about to change that story. You're about to tell a different story that will throw your friends off, that they will ever remember they knew somebody like you. And they will even disbelieve it wasn't you. When I was growing up, I was pastoring in a church in Sapele, and the Holy Spirit came one day in 1987. He said, it's time to go. I did not understand what that means. But I followed. And I went with him. And he established another church. And the church that I left, they said I will never be anything. They said I will never be successful. They prayed and prayed that God will not allow me to be successful. Can you imagine somebody praying that God will not give you what God himself has promised to give you? But it's not about what somebody said about you, but what did you say about yourself? Ooh, the power of God is in the house. What is the dream that you have concerning yourself? What are you telling about yourself? What's your story? You have listened to your friend's story for too long. What's your story? You have read somebody's history for too long. What is your story? And I went to God and built an altar. And I told God on that altar, they said, I will not be successful. But I want to remind you your word. Your word said, this book of the law shall not depart from my mouth. And that I should meditate therein day and night. And the Bible says, I will be successful. And I will prosper when I meditate on your word. And I began to meditate on his word. And I promise I will read the Bible every year. Every year, Genesis to Revelation. So every day, I started reading 3 chapters some years ago. 3 chapters every day. Because if Abraham was successful, I will be. And I don't have to deceive anybody. I don't have to preach error. I don't have to cajole anyone. I don't have to preach what you want to hear, but what the Holy Ghost gave me to preach. Because I know that I know that I know that I know that I know. God bless Abraham alone. God can bless me by himself. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah in the house. I was preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. I was in Nebraska, and the room that I stayed had a full-length mirror. I dressed up one day, and I looked myself in the mirror. I said, you will preach the truth. You hear me? You must preach the truth to all nations, and you will not deceive anyone, and you will be blessed beyond and above measure. In the name of Jesus, I spoke to me in the mirror. When you get home, spoke to you. And I began to set up that altar. I began to read that scripture. 3 chapters every day. Every year, I finished the scripture. Every year, I finished the scripture. Last night when I came. So I read from chapter 16. Of the book of Acts, and I read all down 5 chapters before I entered into worship, and I knew he was already here because I can see it. And every year I finish the Bible, and the people that said I would not be successful, they are still where they were, because backbiters stay in the back. They are not in the front. You are not hearing me. The people that talk you down, they are in the back. And they will always be in the back. And you will always be in the front. But because you are in the front, that's why they see you and they're talking. And they will continue to see you and they'll be talking because they will always be in the back. In the name of Jesus Christ. They are still where they are and they are still talking. And I'm out here in Canada preaching the gospel. And I'm right here in the United States of America preaching the gospel. And God by himself opened the doors. I don't have to push the door. I don't have to force the door. I don't have to tell stories. I don't have to lie to nobody. I don't have to show you anything fake. The door just get open. By itself. when Mephibosheth came to Jerusalem, he started eating with dignitaries. Can you imagine a village boy from desert eating with who is who in the palace? You can tell the Queen of Sheba came to the palace to see Solomon, and other kings come to see David. The palace is busy, right? And they must have lunch before they go, because they have come to see the king. And the butler rang the bell. Your Majesty, dinner is served. And Mephibosheth will sit on the table. And here comes the Minister of Information, the Homeland Security Secretary, and State Department people coming to give the king some briefing, and they are having dinner. Mephibosheth was eating with them. Even if you are stupid, when you are elevated, you are bound to act right. So Mephibosheth had no choice but to act right. And his lameness was covered. The moment he sits on that table, his deformity has been covered. His inabilities are covered. By the dressing on the table. Oh, life fellowship, you're not hearing me tonight. You're not hearing me at all. You are not connecting with me yet. But let me take you to another pedestrian right now. For the Bible says that God has set a table before you in the presence of your enemy. And in the presence of your enemy, he have decided to anoint your head with oil. He has decided to lift you up in the presence of your enemy. God is feeding your enemy with your food on your table, in your house, in your birthday party, in your housewarming ceremony. God has decided to feed your enemy. God wanted to showcase you. He did not invite your friends, but invite your enemy. Your enemy was invited. The people that don't like your face, God invite them. The people that don't want your success, God invite them. The people that don't want to look at you, God invite them. The people that want us, they don't want to celebrate you, but God have invited them. And while they are eating your meal and drinking your water and drinking your orange juice, the Almighty came with a bottle of oil and pour it upon your head. And the Bible says your cup runneth over. And the Bible says that goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life. Do you know what God is doing for you? He's doing something that you cannot and imagine. He pour oil upon your head in the presence of your enemy, so that when the glory of God come upon you in Cannondale, all over the United States, they will know. And why? How would they know? Your enemy will testify. I don't like his guts. I don't like his face. I don't like Pastor Dan. But I was there on that day. I don't like that church. But I tell you, if there's a place you are looking for miracle, that's the right place to go. I can tell you, if you are looking for signs and wonder, that is the place to go. If you are looking for a blessing of the womb, that is the place to go. If you're looking for prosperity, that is the place to go. I was there when God blessed him. They testify for you. That was why God brought them. So it won't be argument in the city of Cannondale. I was there when God anointed him with oil. I was there when God gave him the gift of the word of wisdom, of the word of revelation, of the word of knowledge, of the word of miracles, faith, science and wonder. I was there when God did it in his life. I don't like him, but I was there when God blessed him. And I am a witness to the glory of God in this life. Somebody praise him in the house. So he was there in the altar, in the table of David, that Mephibosheth recover himself so I can eat with the king. So I'm also important. Yes, you are. In the sight of God, you are very important. And on this afternoon, is anybody here that would like to build an altar for his sons? Sons. The Bible says, bring the firstborn to me. God wants the firstborn. The one that opens the womb so that I can bless the first. And when I bless the first, the rest will be blessed. God said, give me your first fruit. Bring me the first of your fruit. Bring me the tithe of your income. So when I bless the first, the rest will be blessed. When I touch the first, the rest will multiply. It's a principle that if you follow that principle, prosperity is an abundant for you. I know you've listened to all kinds of teaching, but this is not a game teaching. It's a principle that will work for you here on earth. Your children, it will work for them. It is a principle of the word of the living God. The Bible says, if you obey me diligently, I will not bring disease upon you, which I brought upon the Egyptians. God said, I will not bring it upon you. In other words, there is a principle for everlasting good health. God will ensure that you are healthy while you are here. Every day of your life. Do you believe that? Am I in the right place? Do you believe that? Thank God I'm in the right place. There is another principle. The Shunammite woman demonstrated it. Jonathan demonstrated it. And in this house today, how many of you would like to build altar for your children? Bring sacrifice upon that altar. Even sacrifice that you normally cannot give, that sacrifice. You don't have the strength to make such sacrifice, but you're going to make it anyway. You're going to follow that principle anyway. I want to pray for 10 people right now that want to build an altar upon this message in this place. I want to build an altar for your children. Altar of abundance. Altar that will never lack. Wherever they go, they will never suffer lack of job. They will never suffer lack of idea. Any day of your life, any day of their lives. And it's not for you alone. It's for everyone that come out of you. Life fellowship. I'm asking for 1,000-fold sacrifice in this place for life fellowship. a thousandfold. A thousandfold seed that will produce a thousandfold harvest. I'm asking for $1,000 in seed this afternoon that will produce a thousandfold harvest. If you are there, please come. That you want to give this church $1,000. Stand up on your feet and come. Process it. Think about it. You want to think? God, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I don't want you to clap. Don't clap. I'm waiting for the rest of you. A thousandfold. A thousandfold seed produce a thousandfold harvest. Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, sir. A thousandfold. A thousandfold that will create unlimited access to blessing for your children. Wherever they are, I'm waiting for you. A thousandfold seed. I don't know all of you. Because if I know you, I will push you into this blessing myself. But I don't know you. So, stand up on your feet and come. It's a sacrifice. You don't have it right now. You have it tomorrow, bring it to the pastor. Whenever you have it, bring it to the pastor. So stand up on your feet and come. I'm waiting for you. I'm waiting for you. God bless you, Cody. Thank you. God bless you. I'm waiting for you. I'm waiting for all of you. Keep coming. Keep coming. The power of God is in the house. Keep coming. Keep coming. Keep coming. I was going to call you, but I choose not to call you. The Holy Spirit pointed to you, and I wanted to say, come. But I didn't want to do that. Let the Holy Spirit Himself bring you out. 1,000 seed that will generate 1,000-fold of harvest. Excellent harvest. God bless you. Keep coming. Keep coming. The Holy Spirit told me to do this as I come to His presence every night in this place. And you will never be the same again. I'm waiting for the rest of you. You can make sacrifice. Go sell some of your gold. Go sell some of your silver. Go sell anything you want to sell. Make this sacrifice. It's good for you and your children. Let this altar that you are building this afternoon speak for you. I'm asking you, not for $5,000, not for $2,000, $1,000 seed for 1,000-fold of harvest. You can pay 2 times, you can pay 3 times, just keep paying to the church, Life Fellowship. Wherever you are, I'm waiting for you. I'm about to pray. Can I have an oil in the house? Do we use oil here? If you don't use oil, no problem. Oh, okay, you use oil. Praise God. Thank you, sir. It is in the Word of God. We are practicalizing the Word. When a seed is planted into the right soil, it's bound to grow and produce harvest. Nobody can stop it. And you have come this afternoon to plant seed. The power of God is here right now. On this ground, on this altar, if you have your check, you want to write it, I want you to write it and place it on this altar that I have called upon the name of the Lord all these nights that I spend with you. And that seed will never go without harvest. Stretch your hands to me. You are the first to come out. Whatever you are planting this seed for, I come before you in the name of the Lord and speak to the unknown in your life. I speak to every mountain. I speak to all impossibilities. I speak to all dangers. I speak to every seed of yours that you have planted, but have not grown or have not produced harvest. Every seed you have planted in this place by the word of the Lord, I command right now,
Harvest, come forth. In the name of Jesus. Harvest, come forth. In the name of Jesus. Yes. You decide to obey God. I give God praise for your life. It's happening to you right now. And every seed you are planting this afternoon. I come in the name of the Lord and decree harvest. Plus all the seed you have planted in the past. I command harvest to come forth. In the name of Jesus. Not just for you, but for all your children. And children, children, I call them back to you. Wherever they are. In the name of Jesus. You are the father of this house. And you are the mother of this house. And I'm glad that you have received that anointing to carry your children. And you will never be the same again. You don't know me. You don't even know where I come from. But you open your house to receive me. For 1 month, you fed me. You care about me. And I prophesy to you today that this your ministry will grow from leaps and bound to all cities. To all cities in America. In the name that is above every name. The anointing of the Spirit of God that He has given me. By the power of the Spirit of God, I ask God to duplicate that anointing in a double way in your life, that your ministry will never suffer neglect anymore. Your word will never fall to the ground anymore. Your word will never be disobeyed anymore. Once you open your mouth and declare it, men and women will gravitate to it. In the name of Jesus, what you are sowing this seed for, I agree with you and call it forth. In the name of Jesus, your obedient work for you, you will never be the same again. Not another day of your life. You choose to honor this world. And what you are building this altar for, I decree this afternoon that this altar will call on those things to come to you in the name of Jesus. So shall it be. What you are building this altar for, I command those things to be called back to you by this altar that you are building in the name of Jesus. You will never lack. You will never lack. Your home will never lack. In the name of Jesus. So shall it be. The power of God fulfill this in your life. So shall it be in your life. What you plant this seed for. May this seed begin to call forth harvest. Even harvest of the seed you have planted in the past. That you have not seen the harvest. I command this seed to provoke unprecedented, uncommon harvest in the name of Jesus. So shall it be in your life, brother. What you are planting this seed for, what you are building this altar for, may this altar begin to call goodness to you, mercy, promotion, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. God bless you, Mama. You will never be the same again. You move in faith. You walk by faith. I decree faith to work for you. I command this altar that you're building by your seed to bring forth uncommon harvest in the name of Jesus. This altar that you build with your seed, I command it to bring to you uncommon harvest in the name of Jesus.
I ask that the anointing of the Spirit of God will rest upon your ministry, that you will grow in leaps and bounds in the name of Jesus. An anointing that cannot be refused come upon you right now. In the name of Jesus. You yielded to the Spirit of God, sir. It was talking to you. It was moving in you. And you yielded. And that obedience bring forth every harvest that you desire in your home, in your life, in your business, in your children, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father. I ask right now that what you are planting this seed for, what you are building this altar for, I ask for this seed to provoke unprecedented harvest in the name of Jesus. So shall it be in your life. This seed provoke unprecedented harvest in the name of Jesus. This seed provoke uncommon harvest in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Now, if you have it here, you want to write check, you write it and lay it upon this altar and give it to pastor, whatever you want to do. God bless you. I hope I don't have to write your name down. If you want to pay it now, put it on the altar. If you want to pay half of it, put it on the altar. Whatever you have, put it on the altar. If you want to write check, put it on the altar. God bless you. Is that okay? Okay. God bless you. Is that yours? Father, this is it. Bless it in the name of Jesus. I bless every one of you in the name of Jesus. I bless every one of you in the name of Jesus. Should I bless you? Come. Yes, come. Come, bring your husband. I didn't ask you to plant seed, so don't be afraid. What do you need? You believe God? You trust Him? Mama, you believe God? You trust Him? When do you want? Lift up your hands. Father, I come in agreement with my brothers. And I ask that this will come to pass in their lives. I ask for provision in the name of Jesus. Unprecedented provision. So that they can be a blessing in the house of God. And they can be a blessing to the body of Christ. So shall it be. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for those of you that are bringing in. Thank you. Thank you, Brother Keith. For those of you that are bringing in, thank you. Thank you. By the Spirit of the Living God, I'm calling for those that will plant the seed of 500 to come so that I can bless you before I go. 500. Come, get up from your seat and please come to the front. I'm waiting for you. Obey the Spirit of God speaking to you. Thank you, sister. I was going to call you, but I didn't want to call you. I know those of you that God put you on my heart to call. But I don't want to call you because you and I know that this, what we're doing, I have suffered a lot in the society. that we don't even know if God is speaking again or God is not speaking. But that don't mean that God is not speaking. God is still speaking. I want you to come. I didn't ask for this, whoever put this here. I'm calling you to sow seed of 500 to build this altar for yourself and your children. Come. Come. It's a sacrifice. He has heard your cry, sister. It's a sacrifice. Come. And pay this sacrifice in this place, because God's glory is in this house. There is no way you can let this glory go by. Come, wherever you are, $500. I'm calling you. Thank you, Mama. Come on. Write the check to Life Fellowship. God bless you. I was going to call you, but I choose not to call you. I prayed for you so much last night. And I saw what I prayed for. I saw the glory of God as you take that worship this morning. And I give God praise. I pray for each and every one of you that I know his name. I call your name. I call your name, middle of the night. Maybe you couldn't sleep last night. Something woke you up and you couldn't sleep. Because I'm bothering heaven on your behalf. 500. Stretch your hands. Give me that oil. God bless you, sir. Come on. The door is not shut. Come. Come. If you want to come, get up and come, please, because I want to start praying. Father, in the name of Jesus, the altar that she built this afternoon. Altars do speak. Altars do draw. Altars even spoke into the life of Jesus. This altar that she built this afternoon begin to speak in the life of the children and children, 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 children. In the name of Jesus. This altar that you build this afternoon and the sacrifice that you place on this altar, may he begin to speak on your behalf and on behalf of your children, children, in the name of Jesus. And every day of your life, this altar will produce harvest, fruit, greatness, and anointing in the ministry. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. This altar that you are building this afternoon, I ask that this altar begin to call your son. Wherever he goes, wherever he is, by the power of the Spirit of God, in the name of Jesus, this altar begin to call your children. Out wherever they are, in the name of Jesus. This altar that you build, speak for you, speak for your ministry, in the name of Jesus, that you will never be the same again. This altar begin to speak prosperity into your home, in the name of Jesus, abundance into your home. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. God bless you. For your obedience, you will never be the same again. Thank you so much. If you want to write check to Life Fellowship, do so. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Well, for the rest of us, I want you to stand up on your feet and bring seed of $20, $50, all the seed. Bring it now. Check your purse and write your check. Do whatever you want to do. $200, write it. Help my sister up. God bless you. God bless you. You will never be the same again. You are getting up into newness in the name of Jesus. God bless you. Come on, somebody put your hands together. Hallelujah.
Come on, bring your seed, bring your offering, bring your $20, $30, $50, $100, $200, bring it right here. God bless you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. So at the back there will bless you forever. Make sure you buy some. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Wherever you are, thank you. Home without sharing the grace, because if you don't share the grace, you might walk in disgrace. I don't want you to walk in disgrace. Share the grace before you go. Come on, bring everything. Bring the 20, bring the 30, bring the 40, bring the 100. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. God bless you. God bless you. All the cities in the back, make sure you have a copy for yourself, especially that of prayer. It was 7 days of teaching on prayer with fasting and praying, and you will never be the same again. Hallelujah. I'm just going to turn you over to pastor. This is the best pastor in the world. Come on, put your hands together for the man of God.
I want those who are going to go on the mission trip to Kenya with us, I want you to come if you would, and I want the bishop just to pray for us for every provision, and just go before us before we even leave. So all those who plan on going to the Kenya missions trip, if you just really come quickly, we're going to have him just pray over us. And I'm believing for a great harvest in that trip. You know that we're going to do crusades, we're going to be ministered to the kids, we're going to be ministered to the ladies. I'm going to be teaching pastors in Kenya throughout the day and training pastors. And so we need God's anointing to do that task. And we're going to be building an oil well and seeing an oil well right there in the village. So we're believing God for great things. Bishop, pray for us. Yes, sir.
Stretch your hands towards our team to Kenya. When you go on missions, the incredible happens. Great things happen, because the Bible says these signs shall go with you. These signs shall go with you. As you move, the sign will follow you. Those that believe, you will see the dead raised to life. You will see the sick be healed. You will see lame rise up to walk. You will see the blind receive their sight. I want you to stretch your hands towards me in agreement. The power of God is here right now. In the name of Jesus, I ask for the anointing of the Spirit of God to rest on you. Anointing of the Holy Ghost. 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 In the name of Jesus, you will never be the same again. Go with the boldness of the Spirit of God. In Jesus' name. Yes. Pass me not by, gentle Savior. Anointing of the Holy Ghost go with you. In the name of Jesus. God bless you. Go and raise the dead. Thank you, sir.
Hallelujah. Glory. Give the Lord one more praise today. Come on. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Bishop will be here Wednesday night, the last night for this season. And we're planning on a prayer conference next summer with him. And he'll be here this coming Wednesday. So one more Wednesday with him. What a blessing he's been to this church. What a blessing he's been to us. And it's been a refreshing for me to be able to sit in my own church and just receive for a whole month. Now I know what it's like. Amen. It's just wonderful. Haven't had that experience in 28 years. I've never not preached an entire month in the last 28 years of my life until right now. And I liked it. Oh, I liked it. It was nice. Nice. Refreshing. If my dad gets here, Barry mentioned the banjo next week, and I won't be playing the banjo. So don't come expecting that kind of thing. We're going to have a great hoedown and have fun like we always do. If my dad is able to make it, I'm going to try to get him to bring his banjo, and the Lord will strengthen him. We're going to have a great time next week. Bring somebody. Pass those cards out. The Life Connection class that we were going to have yesterday, we moved it to November the 10th on a Saturday. And so if you've signed up, that's when it will be. And I know there was others of you, and we had some scheduling conflicts. I apologize for those who did sign up and didn't, and we moved it again. It's just the first time we moved it, but we do that. We're kind of fluid around here. Everybody say fluid. And y'all are good with that? Amen. Let's all stand to our feet. And if you still want to go to the Life Connection about the church membership, sign up at the back November the 10th on a Saturday, and then November the 11th, we're going to have a great time. Father, I thank you so much for this season where you have framed for us a time of refreshing, a time of outpouring, a time of revelation to our life. Lord, we recognize this is the Lord's doing. Isn't it marvelous in our eyes? We give you honor, we give you praise, and we give you glory for great things you have done and will continue to do in our midst. Bless your people today. Bless Life Fellowship Church as we continue to follow, Lord, your voice. We love you. We praise you. We give you honor and glory. Bless the bishop. Strengthen him. Thank you for what you're doing in his family. Be with him safely as they're making preparation to come here, and then he will go back to Nigeria. God, I just pray that you would go before him and make all the crooked places straight in the name of Jesus. Lord, we bless you and we honor you today in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, church. Shake somebody's hand. Tell somebody you love them. Amen to God. If Luke is here, if he's still here. There are CDs for sale on the table back there. Avail yourself to those. God bless you.